Okay, so my talk is going to be obviously about the Amiga 1000 hardware. I'll introduce myself, talk a little bit about the background of Amiga, some of the technological environment that led to the design, the marketing goal, and what we ended up creating for the chipset. So when I first heard about that they were going to be doing a 30th anniversary event, I emailed Bill and said, do you want some of the original team to talk about it? And he goes, who are you? So I sent him the title of some of the patents that had Jay Miner, Joe DeCure, and my name on it. And I contacted Joe up in Washington. He agreed to come down, and together we jogged our memory a lot to try to figure out, you know, from 30 years ago, exactly what we did. We actually had to look up some stuff online to find out, how did we do that? You know, and it turned out that enough people had reverse engineered the hardware that it helped answer some of the questions. But anyway, for some artifacts, and to introduce my opening story, I found this taped to the back of one of my old notebooks. It wasn't the lab notebooks. Those are the lab notebooks from Amiga. Mine are long gone. Joe DeCure had some of his, and I got some information from them. But from 80 to 82, I was working at Apple Computer. And then at the end of 82, this became my business card at, well, originally, that business card was later. Originally, I started it for a company named HiToro. But I'll tell you a little bit about the renaming later. So, some artifacts. And to start off with, obviously, the card at the top is Apple Computer, and that's very much in the news today with, I guess, the fourth movie about Steve Jobs coming out this weekend, and everybody's printing news stories, news articles about it, and, you know, reviews of the movie. But to stay in theme with that, I'll start by telling some Steve Jobs stories, and they actually are related to the Amiga. First of all, I worked in the Apple II group, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later, because some of the ideas for the Amiga I learned while working on Apple IIs. Woz's design in particular, but I was pretty much conscripted to work in the Macintosh group, not by Steve himself, but by Rod Holt, who I think is a character in a couple of the movies, or someone plays him. But anyway, so I got dragged over to the Macintosh group, and I was... First, I was working... I was supposed to actually work on the keyboard. And there's an anecdote about that. At one of the Apple developer conferences, they had something called Stump the Experts, where they, you know, try to ask wild questions and see who could answer it. And one of the questions someone asked was, what's the first Intel processor used in an Apple computer? And they got all the answers wrong. They said some 8086 card you plug into an Apple II, similar to the, you know, 8086 cards that were plugged into the Amiga later. And after all that came up, I jumped up and waved my hands and said, nope, 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 nope. In the Macintosh 128K, if you were to open up the keyboard, you'll find an Intel 8051 derivative. And that's actually the first Intel processor used. But I started on that project, but then they moved me over to some other projects. They canceled doing an integrated circuit project that they were thinking of doing for all their computers. They eventually restarted one for the Apple IIe, and they needed a disk controller chip to go with that for both the Macintosh and the Apple IIe, and that was the first product I worked on there, and so I became the custom chip person in the Macintosh group, because that was the person they threw into that project. So when Steve Jobs decided that the Macintosh needed a clock chip so that when you turned it on, it knew what time it is, Burl Smith and he looked at the existing clock chips in the market, and I forget whether it was for Steve or Burl, but they decided, this is just too inelegant. We don't want to buy someone else's chip. We want to do our own. Yeah. So classic Steve Jobs. He didn't like the looks it took between parts on the board or something like that. So the first company he referred me to was Synertech. Now, a lot of you know that Jay Miner is a key name on the Amiga project, and he was actually a founder of several Silicon Valley companies. Synertech turned out to be one of them. So, but not only did Steve Jobs refer me to Synertech for the first source for the clock chip, but Apple had been burned then by single source components, and so the religion back then was to find a second source for everything possible, especially if it was unique. He said, okay, we need a second source, and I know this really, really good ASIC designer, and he gave me Jay Miner's phone number, who he knew personally, having worked with him at Atari way back in the Atari days when Steve Jobs worked at Atari and Jay Miner was working on the Atari VCS. So that's how I was originally introduced to Jay Miner, one of the founders of Amiga. So I worked with him on the clock chip, but I was fairly happy working on the Macintosh project until one day when I was at my lab bench, I forget what I was working on, and Dan Kottke was two lab benches down, and Steve Jobs walks in and looks at what Dan Kottke's doing and says, "What are you doing?" It's the classic elevator problem. You have I think the current urban legend is you better have a good answer if Steve Jobs asks you that in an elevator, or you won't be an Apple employee the next day. But anyway, Dan Kottke's known Steve Jobs for a long time. He actually went to India with him on a pilgrimage. But anyway, so Dan Kottke says, "It's a test connector." And Steve goes, "Testing connector for what?" He says, "Well, we want to test some signals on the board and perhaps try plugging in some experimental things." "What kind of experiments?" "Well, for instance, wouldn't it be interesting to put color output on a Macintosh?" And Steve says, "No, there will be no color on a Macintosh. We don't want you working on that. Take that test connector off the board." Steve Jobs stomps away. That happened to be just a few days before Jay Miner invited me out to lunch. I went out to lunch with him, and he says, "You know, I know this guy who wants to start a project to do a color video game." And I go, "Oh, okay, well, Steve doesn't want to do color, and I'm interested in doing a color device." And so that was how I got introduced to Dave Morse, the other founder of Amiga, and got me started on the path of working with Jay Miner on the chipset. So the first three of us, I was actually employee number 11. Jay Miner, even though he was employee number 2, didn't actually start at HiToro, which later became renamed Amiga, until after me, because he was under contract with another company that wouldn't let him go, and I'll talk a little bit about that later. So I was the first hardware engineer at Amiga, and the work that Jay Miner, Joe, and myself worked on originally in the architecture for the first few months led to four patents for video games, and later we pivoted it to a personal computer. And I think these patents were first assigned to Commodore, and later they got, you know, passed down the chain. I think they are now, whoever bought Gateway ended up with them.
Aren't they expired by now?
They're expired several years ago. But someone making sure they were clearance wanted to know who they were and what date they expired. So Joe DeCure and I originally worked on this presentation. I'm going to skip some of the slides because some of the slides in this presentation are mostly Joe's, and he knows more about than I am. But I've added a few things because I had more time for my part to fill out a little of the parts of the design I worked on in this presentation. So some of you have seen genealogy charts of the tech companies or Silicon Valley, and they're like an eye chart with like hundreds of companies, you know, starting with Hewlett and Packard before Shockley Semiconductor. Shockley Semiconductor and Varian and Hewlett-Packard, and then basically everything spawned off from them, people leaving companies, founding other companies. I've taken a little piece out of that genealogy to show how the relationships that led eventually to Amiga, and that'll help me tell the story of the technological environment, how it came to be. Joe DeCure's path is on the far side. Fine Engineering was the consulting firm that originally did the prototype for the Atari 2600 video game. And so when Atari wanted to do a video game with a processor in it instead of hardwired logic, they acquired Cyan Engineering, and that's how Joe ended up at Atari. I started out at BTI, actually a little before BTI Computer Systems. I work at a company called Compression Labs, which ended up with some of the earliest patents on JPEG compression and others, and I learned a little bit about compression technology there. Then I worked for BTI Computer Systems, where I learned how mini computers are designed and how mini BTI computer is, even though they were designing a mini computer, they architected it a little bit like a mainframe computer, where a fairly weak central processor, actually 1 to 4 CPUs as a multiprocessor, were supported by some very high-speed DMA engines for all the I.O. And that's one of the things that allowed a processor that's actually possibly, I don't know, have real benchmarks on it, but it might have been even be slower than an Amiga 1000, but they were designing it for 50 terminals being attached to it. So imagine 50 people getting something less powerful than an Amiga and all sharing it. But that was done with a lot of direct memory access, memory transfer to the terminals, to the disk drives and stuff like that. So the processor only had to do the key logic of the application. Anyway, from there I went to Apple Computer, worked with an Apple II group. And Apple II at that time did not actually have a full specification on the Apple II. When Woz designed the Apple II, he didn't design it with a schematic. So some of the earliest employees at Apple had to reverse engineer and draw a schematic, and then I was in the peripherals group, and one of my things was to reverse engineer a schematic to come up with a spec of how the thing actually worked in terms of timing and power and signal. So I learned a lot about Woz design. One clever thing that Woz did in the Apple II that wasn't in other personal computers at the time is he used something called a time division multiplex interleaved memory. So instead of having a separate memory for video and a separate memory for the computer, he essentially made a memory that was twice as fast as needed for either and shared them between both. So during the video, the Apple II memory ping-pong back and forth between processor access, the 6502, and video refresh. That technology I learned about, and Burl Smith also adopted for the Macintosh, and it turned out to be useful. We did something very similar with the Amiga design. Let's see. There was something else I wanted to talk about in the Apple II, but I forget right now. I'll probably pick it up later. And then Intermedics, let's see, do I have a slide on that coming next? Yes, I do. Startup company requires people with a good idea about some, you know, product that will fill a need in the marketplace, and money to develop it. So where did the money come from? There have been several stories told. The best, the most accurate one I got was that Intermedics was founded by cardiologists who were formed a company to develop both pacemakers and defibrillators. And I recently did a version of this presentation at the Amiga 30 event in Neuss, Germany, near Dusseldorf. And on the way home, I stopped off at the Deutsches Museum in Munich, and they had examples of various things, and I found a pacemaker from roughly this period, and a pacemaker from roughly this period is about the size of an iPod Nano. That's about how big they were that they were implanting in people, and obviously that's fairly big chunk for, you know, to do a surgical implant. So Intermedics was one of the pioneers in shrinking that technology down. And one of the ways they shrink the technology down is the funders of Intermedics also funded a custom CMOS fab company who later also offered both foundry and development services to do a semi-custom, sort of roughly equivalent to standard cell design. And so they had a captive CMOS company that could make CMOS chips that were built to a higher reliability than obviously a lot of consumer merchant semiconductor companies. So as you know, a fab line, its profit pretty much depends on volume. You know, a fab line that develops, you know, produces a few chips, you know, maybe, you know, the military can do that for space launches and stuff like that. But for a company that needs to make a profit, you need a fairly high volume. And Zymos was looking for high volume. That's one of the reasons they actually did the clock chip for the Apple. They were hoping the Mac would have enough volume that they would make enough. But that wasn't really that high a volume. If you remember, the Mac in its first few years really wasn't a good seller. So in looking for an idea, they tried to find a consumer product, and Bert Braddock got in touch with Dave Morse. Am I still on sound?
Yeah,
Bert Braddock got in touch. Bert Braddock was the CEO of Zymos, and he was put in touch with Dave Morse, who was VP of marketing at Tonka Toys, and they decided a good possibility for a very high volume chip would be to do a consumer video game. The Atari 2600 in 1982 with high volumes, significant percentage of the revenue of Toys R Us was based on selling the Atari video game and the cartridges, of course. I remember walking into a Toys R Us and there'd be two aisles of video games, just filling a good percentage of the floor space. So anyway, that was their goal, to put some money into a video game development company. The postscript is that it turns out that the process suitable for ultra-high reliability, low-powered custom pacemakers really wasn't suitable for a high-performance video game. So we ended up, after they had funded us, not using Zymos's process after all. And Zymos, after a couple purchases, no longer existed. One interesting thing is I actually saw the fab line at Zymos, and it was back then they were just in the beginning of building clean room in Zymos, and their fab line was roughly the size of the, you know, where we are now in the hotel. It wasn't a gigantic facility. It did have, you know, sealed doors, but it wasn't like a custom multi-billion-dollar building like they do now for fab lines. This is sort of the dawn of learning how to fab chips in anything other than a, you know, an ordinary lab. Okay. So so Jay DeCure came to Atari from Cyan Labs and was apprenticed to Jay Miner, who had, prior to working at Atari, had founded, like I said, Synertech and at least two other companies. I haven't been able to research the names, but I do know from his bio that he has founded several companies. Joe, these type of engineering jobs, designing video games, you know, I had a similar feeling at Amiga, but Joe said it better. He said, "They're paying me to come into work. They're paying me to come in and design video games and then test them." So it's really a cool opportunity for Joe and myself. Joe not only built the concept prototype for the Atari VCS, but as part of developing test, ended up actually writing a couple of fairly well-selling video game cartridges for the Atari game. They designed several chips. At that time, for their first round, Atari had a little bit of the fear of innovator's dilemma. You know, basically that you'll just keep on improving your current product and the competitors will come in and swamp you. So Atari was fairly quick about wanting to do a follow-on for their video game. And so they started the personal computer system product, which became the Atari 400-800. And Joe DeCure was the chief architect for that. Which also had a three custom chip breakdown and a 6502 And it was the competitor, roughly, of the Apple IIe, IIc, period. So that's Joe DeCare. Joe had more to tell about this, but he isn't here today. Okay, this is a snapshot that we took out of Joe DeCare's notebook. It turned out that even though Atari was fearful of something coming in and taking over the market from the video game, and they did the 400-800, when Joe DeCure and Jay Miner proposed to them, well, let's do the next thing beyond that. Let's do a 16-bit computer with one of these new chips coming out that was announced for next year, the Z8000 or the 68000. And you can see it's, you know, memory, disk controller, video, a lot of things for a high-performance computer. Basically, Atari said no. At that time, they just wanted to do a follow-on for the Atari 800. They didn't want to do something completely new. They got cold feet about keeping on innovating the next thing. So Joe DeCure left, did some consulting. I think it was in audio back then, and Jay Miner went off to be one of the founders of Zymos, the foundry company I talked about earlier. So let's see. I think I talked a little bit about this earlier, about my background, Compression Labs of VTI Computer Systems, two custom chips for the Macintosh. Steve introduced me to Jay Miner, and Jay Miner introduced me to Dave Morse. I don't think I said, but at VTI Computer Systems, I also worked with a very talented software engineer, Bob Parisot, and a technician who was looking to become an engineer, Dave Dean. And I sort of kept in touch with him after I left BTI Computer Systems out. And sometimes a lot of companies, how they're formed depends on who knows who, and it turned out that knowing those two people were very valuable in the creation of the Amiga. Let's see. Here's something I didn't talk about in any of the earlier talks. When I was in the Apple II peripheral group to learn about that and experiment, we had in the lab peripheral cards made by other third parties. One of them was something called the software animated mouth. It was a D to A card that was supported by a primitive voice synthesizer software that actually, they did voice synthesis using only, I think, all the code fit in like 30 or 40 kbytes of memory, and they were doing a reasonably decent voice synthesis. Had a Swedish accent, because that's where they got the phonemes from. But anyway, I played a little with that PDM card. In an Apple II, you didn't have much memory, but I could feed like a half a second of sound directly to the DAC in a software in a timing loop and create very interesting sounds. I said, "Oh, okay." With sort of waveforms in memory, you could create more interesting sounds than just the square wave beeps or boops that you could get out of the standard Apple II. Also, there were some very talented programmers in the Apple II group, and a lot of them said, "Well, you don't need this D to A." And in software, they actually pulse the one-bit speaker on and off by varying duty cycles, and actually by just doing that managed to synthesize some very interesting audio, more than just beeps or boops, almost sine waves, rough bits of voice that someone had digitized. And I thought that was very interesting too. You could, just by pulse width modulation, you could produce a sort of waveform audio. And then having to write a lot of test code for my for the cards I designed for the Apple II, I had to learn 6502 assembly language. So I'd sit out there in the section, and across the hallway with the software group and talk with a lot of people. And one of the people I talked with was Bill Budge, who is a famous game developer who wrote Raster Blaster, one of the first pinball emulators for the Apple II. But we'd discuss how he wrote the code, and he said, "I wrote the code very similar to how Bill Atkinson wrote the code for the Apple Lisa, sort of bitblit code where you cut bits of graphic memory out from one place and paste them into another, and that and move the character around, all done in software, all done in the, you know, 1 megahertz 8-bit processor. One of the other things was there was a junk bin. Oh, at Apple II back then, I forget how many employees they have now. It's over 100,000. Back then, Apple II, Apple Engineering, which included the Apple II, the Apple III, Jeff Raskin with the Macintosh and two offices off in the corner, the Lisa Group, a disk drive development group, a video card development group, and there are a couple other groups, fit in one office building. One single office building down in Bandley. That was all of Apple Engineering back then. We were all together. And so I could see what was in the Lisa Group's junk bin, and they had thrown away prototype mice. So I rescued, I think it was 2 dead mice, and by swapping parts made 1 working mouse, and actually then learned how to do some user interface sort of emulation software back then. And again, in 6502 code, it was a combination of 6502 code and a language called Forth, which is a little more high performance than writing in BASIC back then. So that's my experience prior to Amiga, and I took a lot of that into Amiga for various things we did later. So I saw some of the questions online about why didn't you do this, that, or the other, some very fancy features, and I'm going to put it in perspective. I say where it came from. You know, you think of what a computer is now, and why isn't the Amiga 1000 closer to it? And in actuality, where we were then, it was a fairly big step ahead. We had the best-selling video game back then, which was the Atari VCS, the 2600. The 2600 had, I think, 128 bytes of memory. Not kbytes, not megabytes, 128 bytes of memory. You know, if you saw a plot of the chip, you could probably count the bytes by eye with a magnifier. And the technology then was the hardware sprites, little hardware engines to draw things on the screen, and there were a limited number of them. And the clever game programmers learned how, by figuring out where the thing was being drawn on the video screen, drawn line by line, by following the beam, they could reuse sprites and change the configuration of the game at particular locations on the screen. This is all done in software, all done in timing loops. But it was interesting to know that that's how game developers thought back then. The Apple II, again, I talked about the time vision, the multiplex unified memory, and the software pulse width modulation techniques people were playing with. So that these were the products that were had been selling for a few years. Introduced the year before was the IBM PCXT 4.7 megahertz 8-bit processor again. And the Apple Lisa was introduced just after HiToro was founded. HiToro was founded in late 82, and we knew the Apple Lisa had been rumored, and we knew it was going to be announced. It was announced in 83. But in today's dollars, an Apple Lisa would cost roughly about as much as a BMW or a Mercedes. It wasn't exactly an affordable personal computer. It was definitely a high-end office appliance. And these are roughly what the existing technologies we were dealing with. Some of the questions are the video of the Amiga, you know, compared to what we have today is a little strange, but that's because this was just at the period where people were doing computer monitors, and before then, when the Apple II and Atari first came out, the only video display you could get was to hook it to a color TV set. And later, using the guts of a color TV set, the cathode ray tube, they could build the first color monitors, which were essentially converted TV sets if you looked inside them, with slightly higher bandwidth on the video input, maybe RGB instead of demodulating the TV signal. There were computer companies were starting to do higher resolution monitors, but those were all monochrome. I think the military had some color monitors that were higher resolution than a television set, but again, they cost as much as a Mercedes or a BMW to buy. They were definitely not in the affordable range. The only thing affordable were essentially converted TV sets, NTSC in the US, PAL in Europe, and that's what we had to deal with, and it didn't look like it was going to change anytime soon. It turned out it changed faster than we thought, but you know, a lot of things changed in different ways than we could predict. As for audio, what was the technology of audio back then? Well, just about the same time HiToro was founded, Sony announced the first CD player, and adjusted for inflation, I found the price was about $1,600. So again, something that a wealthy audiophile could buy, but definitely far more expensive than your typical hi-fi or TV set back then. Memory cost, why didn't we use, have more addressing capability in the Amiga 1000? Well, 64K bytes was over $100 in dollars back then. I haven't adjusted it for inflation, but I think that's over $200 in today's dollars. So essentially, if you're trying to build something that you could sell on Toys R Us for $200, you can't put $100 of memory in it. So we were actually thinking we might have to have configurations of the first device we built use less than 64K bytes of memory. And so that's where some of the decisions about the video configuration came from, to allow the flexibility of being able to use very little memory and still do bitmap memory. The technology was 4-micron NMOS. As you know, when you design chips now, you have an extensive array of CAD tools, from synthesis tools, layout tools, place and write tools, design rule check tools, logic synthesis tools. I'm naming a small fraction of what a company would end up acquiring and learning to use to build a custom chip nowadays. We had none of that back then. The computer technology that we had to design was an Apple II that we used to synthesize PAL equations. When the Lisa was announced, we put our name on the list and got one of the first Lisas to do documentation. And the software group, 6 months after we started, bought a Sage mini computer, which was a 8 megahertz 68,000 that they put 8 users on. So that was all the computers in the entire company for roughly the first year or year and a half, I think. One of the biggest constraints was the only affordable package for anything in roughly in the personal computer video game range were 48-pin DIP packages. We actually architected it for plastic DIP packages. It turned out the chips ran a little hotter, so I think some of the early Amigas, they may be in ceramic packages. But we wanted to get even less expensive than that, plastic DIP packages. People asked, why couldn't we go with more pins? Well, the next step up of more than 48-pin packages were mil-spec packages, which cost an order of magnitude more. So adding one more pin would have increased the cost of building the system enormously. Okay. So marketing requirements. Dave Morse came from Tonka Toys. He actually brought several of the marketing and sales people with him. One of the stories that's mistold is the marketing of Atari joysticks and such was a smokescreen to hide what we were really doing. It was no, Dave Morse was a marketing vice president. He knew what he was doing. He was essentially seeding the channel so that basically the sales channel would be familiar with our products and know that we could ship on time and we'd have press relationships and stuff like that. So one of the main reasons was to bring in a little money, but was also to work the marketing and advertising channels. So that's what roughly the half dozen people before I started at Amiga were doing. We're working on a Atari joysticks and a platform you could stand on, essentially a foot joystick. But anyway, So what was the marketing goal that Dave wanted to do to sort of make something you know, that he could sell into his channel? And he knew that a lot of the toys back then were marketing tie-ins with essentially the movies and the TV shows that kids like to watch. And similar to how Disney is now has lots of toys and books and stuff that are tied into the Pixar movies, and what is it, the Frozen movie? You go into a store now, there's tons of light blue toys and stuff like that. They probably ship hundreds of millions of dollars, that stuff. But anyway, Dave knew that that was a way you could tie in and get some marketing traction on video games. And he wanted to be able to build games that essentially could create cartoons of the characters that kids sort of were familiar with from media, and Smurfs, I think, was one of those popular shows back then. And so we joked about, you know, putting Smurfs on a game and animating it. And so basically, to pick a target, to pick a way to make Amiga stand out, because you know, essentially, video games and the Apple II and software, they could you know, animate characters and do things. I can't remember the name of some popular games right now, but they had several animated games in the Apple II, but we decided to stand out. We wanted to be able to go 10 times faster, at least, than any existing game machine or PC could do using their software techniques. So software timing loops in the Atari VCS and software bitblit in the Apple II as the popular game platforms back then. Jay Miner was thinking ahead, and he said, well, not only do we want to do a great game machine, but let's add enough expansion stuff so that you could, you know, maybe sell plugins and add-ons for, you know, a keyboard, a pointing device, you know, a disk drive, and other things. That turned out to be very valuable later when we had to pivot away from doing a video game. So basically, we took the software animation techniques that we knew about. In Atari, a VCS, it was software timing loops following the beam, knowing where you're drawing each character in the frame. And the video games that I was familiar with that Apple II developers were doing, which is software bitblit. And we wanted to create a hardware architecture around those as the principal engine for creating a game machine that could do high-performance animation and video. So, okay, so let's see. What did we do to try to get there? Well, the first thing I wanted to do, since, like I said, all the affordable monitors were based on video, was the Apple II could output video also, and I think the Atari could hook to a TV set also. But if you tried to plug them into a VCR, you would get a very bad signal or no signal at all, because it turned out that most of the machines that could hook up to TV back then sort of cheated a little on the accurate timing, NTSC timing, PAL in Europe. They didn't do interlace, the front porch and color bursts were slightly off. And so one of the things I took this opportunity to do, since I didn't like the fact that I couldn't plug my Apple II into a VCR, was to clean up the timing and make it so that it was essentially a studio quality timing. I don't know how close we got, but we got close enough that later people could add on Genlock and do the video toaster. So we must have gotten fairly close. I know that you could take an Amiga and plug it into a VCR. So that was one of the first things we did, is when we started out to do the initial memory and system timing, was we made accurate NTSC timing. That's also one of the reasons that all the system timing in the Amiga 1000 is based off the 3.58 color bursts, so that we could design a synchronous system that would lock with the color and pixel clocks needed to do video. Since I had worked at a company that had done a mini computer that used some mainframe technologies, channel-driven I/O, similar to what IBM did with their mainframes, we wanted to offload the 68,000 as much as possible. And so we did that in the architecture. We wanted to do essentially direct memory access DMA I/O engines, channel engines, essentially to do as much of the memory to memory and memory to various process transfers as possible. So the 68,000 software would only have to set it up, and after the setup, it would sort of handle most of the transfers itself. To do some of the setup, even to take off some of the setup, we wanted to do a coprocessor, and we generalized the coprocessor to be a DMA engine also. So instead of building a specialized processor to set up video, we actually made it yet another DMA channel, simplify the architecture, make it all more uniform. It turned out this flexibility programmers took a lot of advantage of programming it. And it also, Atari had some patents on video displayless processing, but generalized coprocessors, the IBM patents had expired. So Jay sort of steered me away from doing the specialized processor, and we just made it sort of a generalized DMA channel, and that led to the copper coprocessor. And then again, the bitblit was the predominant way that Apple II games were developed. We did that in hardware, cutting and pasting splites in with a mask outline, so you could cut them in without, you know, square edges showing around them. Bitplane video was done to conserve memory. Essentially, you could reduce eight. Let me think now. I'm trying to remember. I might have another slide later, but basically. A video frame in 8 bits would fill all of memory in, I think, 128K system. So obviously we had to use much less, I'll look that number up later. But anyway, so we couldn't do what's typically done nowadays of 24 bits per pixel or 8 bits per pixel, and even 4 bits per pixel would fill up all of memory on the lowest end system we could contemplate selling, which might have less than 64K of memory. So we, to allow a flexibility in the amount of memory used for video, we sliced the video up in bit planes, which allowed 2 bits, 3 bits, 4 bits. I'm not sure if anyone used 5 bits, and then 6 bits for the highest resolution mode. And at that point, we ran out of chip area and memory bandwidth, and we couldn't go much beyond 6 bits per pixel. And as I said, I'd studied some compression image compression technology at a prior job, and we didn't use image compression was fairly logic intensive. You couldn't really do that, but the little bit of just compressing the color, it turns out that color in video and typical images is compressible by something called differential encoding. And so we did something, a little bit of differential encoding, where you could change the colors bit by bit on pixels, and we didn't know the right name for it back then, so it ended up being called hold and modify. But it's really a differential encoding for color compression. And then 4-channel sampled audio. The Macintosh had stereo audio. Well, some of you had a Macintosh know it really didn't have, it. You couldn't plug in and get stereo out. It turned out that Burl had to steal one of the stereo channels in the Macintosh to vary the speed of the originally the Twiggy disk drive that they were planning on using. And that's one of the reasons the Mac only had 1 channel, architected for 2, and I wanted to do better than that. So we put 4 channels in, and like I said, I experimented with waveform sampling, so we made it a sampled, digitized audio engine, and the technology now is to do waveform synthesis with waveform resampling. Waveform resampling requires a fairly powerful ALU and signal processor, so we just cheated by changing the sample rate. And so that's how we got pseudo-variable sample rate waveform synthesis. To get a volume control on that, essentially make 2 dimensions. We did 1 dimension by the pulse width and the other dimension with a small on-chip DAC. And so that's how we could get a volume control without actually putting a multiplier on the chip. Again, a multiplier back then took more area than you could actually fit on, you know, a reasonable sized portion of a custom chip back then. And the configurable interrupt system, which we locked the video timing, again, using the knowledge of the Atari video game software developers who followed the beam, we essentially allowed the 68,000 to follow the beam using not just timing loops, but interrupt systems. And it turned out the software team took great advantage of that to build the multitasking operating system, because we built a fairly flexible interrupt system onto the custom chipset. So this slide I didn't finish, but 525 line NTSC. This is a field, this whole thing is a frame, and the way the Apple II and Atari cheated is they only displayed one field on top of each other, half of the 525 lines, or 40 visible vertically. It turned out by delaying the time you start the next frame, the lines get drawn half a line lower and you end up with interlaced video. And so we did, unlike the Apple II and Atari VCS, we did 525 line fully interlaced, and the timing again was offset by half a line so we could actually get the interlace. Using the technique that Woz had done of a double speed memory was one of the things we put in the Atari. Basically, while you were displaying video, the processor had no memory access. The processor accessed memory during blanking, when essentially the cathode ray beam was flying back across the screen or back to the top. And so the processor access was only in this space. We did a double speed memory so that essentially the processor running in normal mode would have access to every other cycle, the entire frame, which is as fast as a 8 megahertz 68,000 could run, actually. And then that left lots of time in here for memory accesses for the coprocessor, for audio, and if you wanted to do blitting without slowing down the processor, you could blit only in blanking. It turns out that people used more blit performance than that. But anyway, that's how we wrung some of the performance out of memory without slowing down the processor. Okay. Graphic animation. Okay, so let's see. The best CPU, we didn't really look much at the Z8000. I think National Semiconductor also had another 16-bit chip back then, but it was late. But basically, Apple, in negotiating with Motorola, had already driven the price of the 68,000 fairly low. And so obviously that was the one to choose for a processor that would give us headroom over the 8-bit video games and personal computers at the time. Again, we did a full NTSC TV resolution bitmap rendering with interlace, planar pixel format so it could fit in memory, color differential encoding I talked about before, DMA processors, and then bit blitting, which the name came from University of Utah, Xerox Alto, eventually Apple Lisa, but as I said, the game programmers had sort of reinvented it on their own. And then the classic Atari sprite engines. I think the VCS had two or four. Does anyone remember? I don't have Joe co-presenting with me, so he's the one who is obviously the architect of that system, but we decided to do 8 on the Amiga, which I think is double the amount. Okay. So we talked about following the beam, being able to do different things with your software depending exactly where the timing was doing, drawing your video frame on the screen, doing different things at the top and the bottom. We based the interrupt system and a lot of the DMA off of the timing, so we could do similar things both with the DMA engine as well as the processor. And we had registers for horizontal and vertical for each for that were loaded by the copper to figure out what to do next. Let's see. We generalized the DMA engine by having it transfer directly from memory into not only the special purpose functional units, but into any I/O register on the chip. And again, we generalized it to simplify the hardware, but the game programmers took advantage of it to do all sorts of creative things because it was a generalized engine. The coprocessor basically programmably took that out of memory and could put it in the chip register bus, put it into registers in any of the three chips. For blitter, sprite setup, audio setup, interrupts, all reprogrammable by a DMA engine. Resolution, in color 320, 640 across on a color system, you'd get some artifacts, but you could do that in monochrome, bit plane oriented to conserve memory, palette registers, you could do color lookup, and then as I said, the color compression by hold and modify. This is just a slide Joe put together to show how much memory video takes compared to how much memory we would wanted to put in the system. 32, we shipped with originally 128 kbytes of memory. Let's see. BitBlit hardware. So again, I first saw that demonstrated in software in Apple II. And the technology is to animate a cartoon image on a background. You take the background, bitmaps for the background, all bitmaps. You take the bitmap for the character, and if the character isn't square and you wanted to place it on there, you have to do a little outline cutout of both the background and the character and paste in just the part of the character that fits inside the outline. And that's what the BitBlitter did. It was a custom engine to do that. How am I doing for time? Am I good? Okay. Okay. Okay, just wave at me on the way out. Okay. And then after running it through a logic unit, we wrote it back in the background. That could be done, obviously, with some ands and ors, but we sort of... this was done actually before we had any software people on board, and Joe and I talked back and forth about what we thought the software people would want in terms of logic operations for ands and ors and masks and stuff like that. And after not being able to decide, we just we had the brilliant idea of just why not just do the logic by a lookup table. So it turns out what we did was we reinvented an FPGA three-input LUT. And it turned out that the Amiga patent submitted was submitted right about the same time Xilinx submitted the first patents for FPGAs. So history, a lot of things ended up getting invented at the same time. If we had thought of this in terms of a LUT, we could have written the first patent for the first FPGAs as well as the first, you know, video computer. But anyway, that generalized logic, essentially we used an FPGA LUT primitive as the logic unit for the Blitter. One regret is when I later found out that we had reinvented the FPGA LUT, as I said, why didn't we put in carry logic? If we put in carry logic, we would have had a generalized, we would have had one of the first, you know, personal vector computers, given the Blitter. But, you know, water under the bridge. Okay, BitBlit logic. This essentially is just a fancy diagram for a lookup table, a decoder, and a lookup. To move the image smoothly, you have to put barrel shifters in so you could move things not by byte boundaries, but by bit boundaries. As you move things between two sets of input registers, you have to save the previous one so you don't have gaps moving the characters around. And all of that was done fetching from memory, shifting it if necessary, running it through the logic unit, and sending it back out to memory. And that was how you could put a animated character onto a background of a video display. Let's see, I think Joe did this one, but essentially a sprite character, the cutout, basically you cut this size hole out of here and then pour that in and you end up with your tank on your colored road. Okay, I think Joe did this slide. I think what he's trying, the way I would have, I didn't do the slide, the way I would have done it is we put basically some fill logic into the blitter so that instead of having, if you had large areas in the screen, instead of having the processor or the blitter having to fill out all of it or get a template to fill out all of it, we put logic in to essentially use an exclusive OR chain to fill from one line segment to another. So you could actually sort of draw, with lots of constraints, you could draw a polygon and fill it in. And then you could, we could build large background areas and also mask and templates using this. So that was one of the things that isn't a classic thing that you'd normally see when you see a bit blitter described in the technical literature that we sort of threw into our implementation of the bit blitter. Basically draw two lines and fill in the space in between the line, done with by an exclusive OR chain. Essentially, you hit the first pixel, turn to black, hit the next pixel, turn back to white, and continue on as the blitter scans along the frame. Sprite engine, I'm not as familiar with the sprite engine, so I'll have to skip over most of the slide except for reading it off, because Joe DeCure was the architect of the sprite engine, both in the Atari VCS, Atari 400, 800, and he did most of the architecture for the bit logic on the Amiga 1000. But essentially, completely without software, you could set up essentially an overlay, an image overlay, where in hardware, it would fetch, or in this case, out of a register, some pixels, and when the time was right, just plaster them on top of the background image. And we had 8 of them, and they could all be reprogrammable on the fly, which, again, software people reuse. So even though we had 8, they'd wait until it was used in the first location on the screen and then reuse the same sprite engine later, so they could put dozens or possibly hundreds of objects on the screen just using the sprite engine without having to draw on memory and erase and redraw. Sprite engines, essentially they were DMA'd in, and they had a horizontal and vertical start, and the image, and those were essentially a object block, sort of like an object-oriented program, and the DMA would fetch an object from memory and set it up for the hardware engine to handle. Audio, 4 independent audio channels, 8-bit samples audio. Again, we cheated. We didn't actually resample the audio at a constant rate. We changed the sample rate by dividing down the color clock. And then the DMA engine had memory pointers and a length, so you could loop and essentially use one period of a waveform and repeat it. The clever circuit design engineers put a resistor ladder on the chip to do a multiplication for the volume control. And then the audio channels were then summed and fed to the audio output amplifier external to the chipset. I think this is fairly obvious. If you can have a waveform, you can have anything as the waveform. Sine, triangle, square, whatever. Pseudo-random patterns turned out to be useful for generating noises and bangs and things like that. One of the first demos we did was we recorded Jay Miner brought his miniature dog in Mitzi, sort of the mascot of the project throughout the entire development, and we recorded Mitzi barking, and then put that in memory, and by changing the pitch with the keyboard, essentially you could make Mitzi bark out a tune. So that was one of the first demos to prove that, yes, we could do interesting things with this. Finished system. This is a replay of it. A lot of decisions were made because 16-bit and 8-bit buses, you add those up with, you know, a power and ground and control pins, and pretty soon you hit the 48-pin limit. The division pretty much was, most of the addressing was done in Agnes. The blitter was in Daphne, which later got renamed Denise. And the audio engine and a lot of miscellaneous stuff, disk controller and serial, was put in Porsche. I think that was later renamed Paula. And there's several other names as the ships got enhanced, moving on to future products beyond the Amiga 1000. Details. As I said, I worked on the Apple II and one of the, let's see, I had purchased a disk controller board for an S100 computer prior to my working at Apple, and it was a board with, I think, 50 or 60 chips on it for the disk controller. Woz condensed that down. If you exclude the ROMs, I think he did the disk I/O in 5 chips, you know, plus ROM and some buffers. But anyway, so how did he do that? He basically read in the disk transitions, the magnetic transitions, in raw format and decoded them in software. So he didn't need a lot of hardware to do it. And he used a format called a GCR, which is slightly less dense than MFM, but allowed for cheaper disk drives. So we did something similar with the Amiga. We could read in raw magnetic transition pulses and then allow the software to decode. We sped it up to double speed so we could decode not only GCR for in case we wanted to use some really cheap magnetic media, but MFM, which is what we ended up using with the higher quality micro floppies. I did a serial card for the Apple II, super serial card. It was actually on their price list for over a decade, one of the longest selling Apple products ever. I'm sort of proud to accomplish that as even the obsolete technology. But anyway, one of the things I was got complaints about and took the chance to fix was the serial card I did for the Apple II couldn't do MIDI baud rates. And of course, musicians want to do MIDI input and output, and you had to get a separate card and have multiple cards in your Apple II to do MIDI. So I made sure the design of the serial port for the Amiga could do MIDI, which again led to its use in multimedia quite a bit. The three-chip partition, Joe DeCure will say it's similar to the way that they did it at Atari. Actually, I had the pinout budget and basically we partitioned it because that was the only way that we could split up the logic units and not run out of pins. So there were actually two reasons we ended up with a three-chip partition. And also to move units around so they'd fit on the various dies. Actually capable of doing YIQ, it's just no one puts a YIQ similar to CCR 601, what they use now for digital video as the output. As a postscript, after many years after I worked on the Amiga, I worked at Silicon Graphics. I did a small portion of, let me back up a little. That may be a few slides later. The Amiga did not succeed as a game machine because the game market crashed. We had to pivot to a personal computer. It's sort of a regret for never doing a game machine. Several of the Amiga early software people and hardware people moved on to do the handheld game, which later became the Atari Lynx, and the 3DO. Sort of, there's their chance to try to do a game machine since they had failed to do a pure game machine with the Amiga. Several years later, I worked at Silicon Graphics, and I loaned myself to a group which just happened to be doing the chipset for the Nintendo 64. And so I got to do the audio unit of the Nintendo 64 chipset, and the follow-on for that, actually, the proposal was everybody was doing an RGB chipset. They were actually started out doing a YIQ. This was going to be a 3D Silicon Graphics game engine, but when they spun MIPS off and other technologies, and SDI eventually crashed and went bankrupt, that project was canceled. So I had a chance twice to do a YIQ machine and failed both times. And collaboration. One of the advantages of a small startup company without layers of management, compartmentalization, is everybody could do everything. Like I said, I wrote some of the first test software and demonstration software for the Amiga. Del Luck was in the software group and knew enough about reading schematics that he looked over some of the schematics being worked on by Dave Dean and said, just by adding a few logic units here, we could add line draw to the blitter. And so he very cleverly added a incrementer and a line draw engine to the Blitzkrieger, and that's an example of collaboration, close collaboration with the software team, allowing them to tweak the hardware design, and we ended up with some very important features by not just compartmentalizing software and hardware and designing to spec. So, project history. I started at HiToro in late 82, I think maybe right around December, and Jay Miner and Joe DeCure started just a few weeks later, and we sat in a room a little smaller than this with four whiteboards and spent essentially 3 months drawing on the whiteboard and erasing the whiteboard. Drawing on the whiteboard and erasing the whiteboard. And eventually, we ended up not erasing everything, and we actually had a design left. And we at that point, we had roughly the three-chip microarchitecture, all the pieces. We started creating the register maps. I wire-wrapped 268,000 motherboards. I'm sort of guilty. Only one of them worked reliably. I never debugged the other one. Dave Needle, a later engineer, sort of was frustrated that I only could get one of them working. Detailed circuit and logic design. Jay Miner hired Mark Hsu and Edwin Chu to do the circuit design. They were people he had worked with at Atari, and they started designing the actual transistor circuits that would be behind the logic gates that that I was working on. And later, to finish out the logic design, we hired Glenn Keller from MIT and Dave Dean. Like I said, he was a technician that I had worked with at BTI Computer Systems. He wanted to be an engineer, so I said, you're sharp, we'll hire you and make you an engineer. And so he did one of the custom chips. And also from, I forget how many months in, I called up Bob Pariseau and talked him into coming on board. He came on board as the VP of software and later hired the rest of the software team, RJ Delluck, Carl Sassenrath, several others. Later we hired a couple more consultants, including Dave Needle, to build us three very large TTL chip emulators. If you've ever seen pictures of these, they're boards about the size of a large notebook stacked in a circle around a central core. The idea came from my having read a book on how the Cray 1 was architected with all the wiring in the center of a cylinder to keep them short, and we needed to do that in this as well. These chips had dozens of boards with hundreds of chips on them with thousands of wires. I think we were astoundingly lucky that these things stayed reliable enough for us to demo them. RJ has more stories, and Dave Needle has more stories about things going wrong every time we move them. I didn't touch them. I got them working and sort of said, I'm not going to exhale near them. We took them down to the CES trade show. Do I have an artifact from that? I don't know. I've dug through some boxes and I actually managed to find this. The 84 CES, essentially prior to Comdex, this was the big computer show down in Las Vegas. And we went down there, and outside our locked booth, we had the Atari joysticks and Joy Board. We hired a couple models in a skimpy outfit to sit on top of the Joy Board and wiggle around, you know. So that's how they do things at trade shows. But we had in the booth in the center was a solid walled off and a locked door. And under NDA to key executives we were looking at for investment or relationships, we showed off the TTL emulators. And people kept on, after the demonstration, people kept on walking around the demonstration booth wondering, where did we hide the VAX mini computer or whatever that was necessary to run those demos? Because they didn't believe that that pile of chips could do it. That's something that's small enough to sit on the table. They were looking for, you know, some big rack of computers. That, you know, back then a VAX was about the size of a Sub-Zero refrigerator, and I think the graphics output port was another box the size of a Sub-Zero. So they were looking for something that, but we managed to do it all with a pile of boards of chips. So let's see, back here. CS Trade Show, CAD tools. We already talked about the fact that we had no CAD tools until our very last stage. We drew schematics, logic gates with little templates, pencil, erasers on vellum. We hired some layout artists. They had color pencils on RubyLith, on vellum. Again, transferred that to colored tape on RubyLith. And at the very last stage, they brought in a digitizer puck to mark out the corners of each piece of colored tape, and that's the only piece of technology we used for the tape out. The only thing that was used electronic was the digitizer to get the XY coordinates into the tape. Everything else was done strictly manually. I remember spending late nights with a metal ruler over a light table on RubyLith, measuring the space between certain combinations of transistors to do my part in the design rule check. As you can imagine, it was extremely time consuming. No one in their right mind would do a chip like that today. No one in their right mind. Perhaps no one in their right mind should have done a chip that way back then. Three of them. But we taped them out, and believe it or not, the first silicon mostly all worked. I think there was one semi-blocking audio bug, but almost everything else we could demo pretty much like we could demo the TTL towers. So I don't know whether that was luck or you know, something looking down on us, but anyway, it actually all worked. And like I said, that number of transistors, well over 100,000, probably close to 200,000 transistors, all hand laid out, drawn on paper. But What did we end up putting it together, those chips together, what did we end up putting together as a product? Well, it turned out in 83, Atari had overdone the let's take a cartoon popular with kids or a movie popular with kids and create video games off them. They didn't realize that the games actually had to be fun to play. They sort of lost that concept. So they were licensing things left and right. I think the ET was the one most popularly blamed. But there were several other products in the area that were essentially games designed by marketing people who had no idea what was fun to play. And so they essentially built so many game cartridges, and the toy stores took such a high inventory, and they sat on the shelf because kids obviously knew better than not to spend their money on a game that was no fun to play. And so they ended up bulldozing a bunch of video game cartridges. The video game industry, from the financial, according to the financial markets, crashed, which obviously affected management decision. It turns out the number of games that people actually purchased didn't crash as bad as the financial reports made it out to be, because kids still bought the good games. They just didn't buy all the games that were being produced, which is, you know, a large portion of the volume back then. But that was enough to affect the market. So we had to pivot to a personal computer, and it turns out that J-Miner's foresight to put a little corner of the logic that could do, you know, keyboard input, disk controller, and a few other things, and again, the mouse pointer, I demonstrated the reconstructed Lisa mouse for him. We all those things we considered were going to be add-on cards, they became, you know, essentially necessary features to pivot and make it into a personal computer. And the software team, of course, jumped on that and built a multitasking operating system suitable for the personal computer, and then that was introduced in 85, 30 years ago, as the Amiga 1000. And that was our resulting product, product for all the efforts we made. And let's see, do I have anything else? Minor thing, another idea I stole from Apple is Steve Jobs says artists sign their work. And here's Steve Jobs' signatures, Woz's signatures down here. And even though I had left the Macintosh group to jump over to Amiga, Steve Jobs was very gracious, and my name is sitting still there in the back of the plastic of the Mac 128K. And I told Dave Morse about that, and he said, okay, we can do that for the Amiga too. And so here's Jay Miner's signature, Dave Morse's signature, the most famous one, Mitzi's paw print. And then I got to sign my name down there with the rest of the software and the hardware team. People, you know, brilliant hardware engineers, absolutely essential to the success of this project. So, summary, I've talked about the architecture, hardware design, and marketing requirements that led to a high-performance graphics and personal computer system, three full custom ASICs, hand-designed by an insanely small team for what we ended up accomplishing of brilliant software and hardware engineers, and somehow we ended up creating a creative, an innovative feature set that managed to keep the system popular among all you guys 30 years later. I'm astounded. And that's the end of my talk. So I saw some people had posted some questions online somewhere. I'm not sure. I found a couple of them, and I actually have a minor answers to a few of them. Some of them, let's see, where did I put that? Rats. Did I? I don't. Oh, I left out a very important part of the presentation. There's some references to learn more. There's some books written on the Amiga. And of course, I have to say that this product would have never happened without our fearless leader, Jay Miner. He passed away about 20 years ago, and he was our leader, mentor, founder of many companies, an inspiration to the entire team that did the Amiga. Some contact info you can find about later. And how do I turn this off? I don't need this off. I'll just go back to the intro. I'll just leave that up for now. So there were some questions. I found a couple questions. Let's see. I had some comments on the. So the questions. A lot of the questions are. Did we think of that? The answer is no. I'll give you the reason. Both Bob Parisot and I had been students of technology, the history of technology. We'd read a book called The Mythical Man Month, and we were very familiar with something called second system design. A lot of engineering companies, computer companies, when you design your first computer, you design it to get it out there, and you learn about all the things you've done wrong and all the things you could have architected to make it completely universal and stuff like that. And second systems, by huge proportion, almost all fail. You know, IBM had their massive next generation project, which was supposed to replace the 360, never happened. Intel did the IA64. And I think they still sell that in like minuscule volumes. Many second systems, especially the computer systems, are massive failures. I think IBM and Apple got together on Pink Intelligent, and they spent millions of dollars that went nowhere, basically because they tried to fix all the problems of their previous product. So about Bob, both, I started doing it, and when Bob Peristo came on board, he helped me, and basically our discipline was we wanted to profile what the programmers needed. We knew they wanted Blip 10 times faster. A lot of other details were not in the profile of the core performance needs. And so basically we said, once we got the key things out of the way, we didn't want to look at how to do it right. We just wanted to look at how to get, you know, we had a goal set in mind and we wanted to be 10 times faster in graphics. We hit it and we sort of cut everything else out. I'll talk a little bit later about some of the things we cut out. I talked about one of them earlier, but pretty much I showed where we came from. You know, 8-bit computers running at 1 megahertz, you know, 128 bytes of memory in the best-selling game machine. We thought 128 kbytes was a factor of 1,000 more. Why do we need to design it for lots more memory? We knew Moore's Law would move on, but again, if you design too far in the future, you might fall into the trap of destroying yourself by not meeting your constraints. Constraints are obvious things. You have to ship the project before your budget runs out. A lot of companies don't manage to do that. You have to ship the product so that it costs enough. And basically, when we got to a certain area of the chip, we decided, you know, instead of trying to, you know, figure out, can we buy a bigger chip and run the cost up by a factor of 10? No, we just decided to stop including things. Pins were a big constraint. They really put the discipline on the design team. It turns out the register map at how many registers we could fit in put in discipline. We couldn't include some features because the control register for it would add up, you know, to excess area. One of the questions that didn't come up was, if we were going to do a multitasking operating system, why didn't we do an MMU? Well, Jay and I spent like 10 minutes discussing it and decided it would make the chip, it would be too big to fit in the chip, so it would slow down performance. Stop considering it. So even though it's a very desirable feature, if we had put it in, a lot of the books on the Amiga, I haven't touched on them at all, talked about how we were within days of running out of money. I think, you know, like, I forget, it was just a handful of days of running out of money. So we just barely made it, or we would have had to shut down before anyone would have took and licensed our technology. Did we think about a better processor than the 68000? Again, Apple had negotiated a good price in 68000. We didn't see anything else being in a consumer price range back then. We decided, you know, Moore's Law would turn in the future, there'd be that more memory, faster processors, new Amiga chipsets, which is what Commodore ended up doing. So we actually didn't architect a lot of future into it. It turns out that the future we architected into it was just enough, and we made it just in time. Let's see, is there anything else that I want to talk about? Questions that I saw. Bill, were there more questions on the list? Oh, okay, yeah. Say again?
What was your interview process like for hiring
others? What was the interview process like for hiring new hires? I'm trying to remember. You know, RJ says I interviewed him, and I don't actually remember. So I do remember interviewing Glenn Keller, and essentially the rule in hiring is it's easy to go downhill. Try to hire people smarter than yourself, and Glenn Keller was answering stuff that, you know, I didn't know about. You can convince me, you know, engineer from MIT, this oceanographer on a government oceanographer's budget where they have nothing to do amazing things. He impressed me that he knew more than I did about a lot of technology. So I think from my point of view, I always ended up hiring people better than myself at a lot of things. I don't remember a lot of the people who say I interviewed them, and I don't remember. Jay Miner referred me to Dave Morse. I got the job because Joe DeCure didn't want to come on board full time. He was their first choice, but But Jay Miner knew that I knew computer architecture from what I had done previously, and so Dave Morse was pretty much just negotiating what my position would be. Yes. Turnover. I'm trying to remember if we had anybody who left from the early days. Like I said, Joe DeCure only wanted to work as a consultant temporarily because he wanted to do his own startup and not be a part of Jay's. So he worked there only, I think, 4 or 5 months with me on the original architecture. And I cannot remember anyone who left before the chips came back working. And the software team, you'd have to ask RJ about. He knew more about what went on the software side of the business after that.
How long did it take to get the chips back up?
That'd be a good question for Joe DeCure. He actually has some dates in his notebook. I do not have those offhand.
Any other questions?
Just a comment. Joe DeCure has joined our club here at SAC. He is probably within the next year going to be coming down to visit us here at SAC, and we will put that on the website so you'll know a date and a time when Joe will be here. Now, he tells me he's got a couple of 500s and a 2000 he wants to resurrect. So that's one of the reasons he's coming. But he also has relatives in this area that he has to visit. He would have been here this weekend if he hadn't already committed to something else. So we want to really thank Rod for coming. Especially after a trip to Europe. You just got back Thursday, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay.
Yeah, what time is it in Germany right now?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. Am I standing sideways?
Yeah, you're still running on that time, I'm sure. But I just wanted to make that comment, and we will welcome your presence as well, Ron, and you want to come up and visit. We meet the 4th Sunday of every month. So, and SAC.org has all of our information on it. But I just wanted to say thanks a bunch for doing this. And as most of you know, the Amiwest budget pretty much doesn't exist. So he's come and done this pro bono. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much for listening to me. Thank you very much for your time.